welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming to another of my talks, this time looking at the world of Beethoven as we did 2 weeks ago. This last 2 weeks ago, we looked at Beethoven and his deafness. Today, we're looking at Beethoven and his relationship with the aristocracy and with Napoleon. In 2 weeks' time, I'll be looking at Beethoven's legacy. Why are we still talking about him 250 years after his birth? Beethoven is the friend and contemporary of the French Revolution, and he remained faithful with it, even when, during the Jacobin dictatorship, humanitarians with weak nerves of the Schiller type turned from it, preferring to destroy tyrants on the theatrical stage with the help of cardboard swords. Beethoven, that plebeian genius who proudly turned his back on emperors, princes, and magnates. That is the Beethoven we love for his unassailable optimism, his virile sadness, for the inspired pathos of his struggle, and for his iron will, which enabled him to seize destiny by the throat. This is a fabulous quote by Igor Stravinsky. As we mentioned in the last talk, Beethoven lived in a period of social and political flux. Due to the Age of the Enlightenment, the French Revolution, and the Napoleonic Wars, the stranglehold that the aristocrats had on society began to be questioned, not only by the lower classes, but also by themselves. Most of Beethoven's musical predecessors had official positions at the court or in the service of the church. Haydn worked for the court of the Esterházys for almost 30 years, wore livery, and was expected to serve the monarchy in any way he could. And Mozart in Salzburg had to eat with the serving staff. Most composers were totally beholden on the monarch or church, had to get permission to marry or change employment, and were told what compositions to write. In fact, Bach was jailed for a short period of time for wanting to change employment without getting official permission from his monarch. Unlike most of his predecessors, Beethoven never had an official position at the court or in the service of the church. He saw himself as an equal, if not better than the aristocrats, because he had talent while they only had titles and, I suppose, money. Prince, what you are through chance and birth. What I am through my own labor. There are many princes and there will continue to be thousands more, but there is only one Beethoven. Beethoven said this to Prince Karl von Lichnowsky, and the audacity of this statement must have been apparent to everyone who heard it. They are the words of a man not lacking in self-confidence or an understanding that his place in the world is different from his predecessors. And history has shown that he's right. The names of many of the important people in Beethoven's life only live on because of the dedications he made to them in his compositions. Prince Karl von Lichnowsky was a very important person in Beethoven's life. A few years after Beethoven arrived in Vienna from Bonn in 1792, Lichnowsky guaranteed him a yearly stipend of 600 florins until he earned a regular income, i.e. working for the court. But this never happened. During his entire time in Vienna from 1792 until his death in 1827, Beethoven remained a freelance musician. One of the reasons he was able to remain without employment was because of the patronage of the nobility. And this is where our quandary begins. This is the time in history where music is increasingly being created for the new middle class. And Beethoven was at the forefront of this development. He was enthusiastic about the French Revolution and shared its ideals of freedom, equality, and brotherhood. Yet most of the compositions that he wrote were commissioned by the rich, the famous, and the noble, contracts which were essential for him to maintain. He knew he couldn't afford to neglect the nobility. Beethoven was born into a family of Flemish court musicians in 1770. His grandfather, who he was named after, was a well-respected music director in Bonn, while his father Johann, was a not so well respected and often drunk court singer who gave Beethoven his first piano lessons. Some nights, Johann would stagger in late at night from the tavern, wake Beethoven up, and make him practice for hours and hours and hours on end as tears dripped onto the keyboard. Beethoven's father wanted to create another Mozart with his son, playing for the royal courts to generate income for the family. But they saw neither fame nor fortune. Johann's drinking debts were so deep that his wife had to sell her clothes. And when Beethoven turned 11, he had to drop out of school and focus on music full time. He never mastered spelling or simple modification, and throughout his life, he often thought he was being swindled because he couldn't work out the simple maths. Now, Beethoven wasn't a child prodigy like Mozart or either the Mendelssohns, Felix or Fanny, but obviously his talent was very impressive. And at 14, he was employed as the second organist at the court of the regional ruler. When he was 17, it was decided that Beethoven should go and study in Vienna with none other than Mozart. Now, there are a whole bunch of apocryphal stories about this encounter between Mozart and Beethoven. The first was that when Mozart heard Beethoven play, he turned to his wife and said, "Watch out for that boy. One day he'll give the world something to talk about." Another is that Beethoven played for Mozart, but Mozart never played for Beethoven. Whatever the case may be, the hoped-for lessons never eventuated because Beethoven got news that his mother, his beloved mother, was critically ill in Bonn, and he had to return there and never had lessons with Mozart. But Beethoven was seven, and I have to say, once he got there, she passed away. Beethoven was 18 on the 14th of July, 1789, when the Bastille prison in Paris was stormed. This event, the start of the French Revolution, brought about a new order based on revolutionary principles of individual liberty and rights. For the German people, it was deep and inspirational. It has planted in heads and hearts essential ideas for the foundation of the future, which only 20 or 30 years ago, most people would have been too afraid to conceive. In fact, at first, even the imperial rulers were impressed. Early in the revolution, both Joseph II and Maximilian France saw the events in France as confirming their ideals of the Enlightenment. So even if Beethoven had never become a full-blown radical, he was exposed to the general sympathy and excitement of these events happening in France. Beethoven also began to take a great interest in a young anti-monarchist general, Napoleon Bonaparte, who, as a hero, was proclaimed the first consul of the French Republic. Napoleon was at the center of a new age, and Beethoven was impressed by this bright new light. So here we have this young, impressionable man whose views are leading towards liberty, fraternity, and freedom, but whose family is relying on him for financial support. The teenage Beethoven starts working as a music teacher for the children of nobility, and one of these families is the cultured von Brüning family, who were devoted to the ideals of the Enlightenment. In fact, Beethoven becomes very good friends with the son, Stephen. And this relationship continues for the rest of Beethoven's life. But when they are living together in Bonn, Stephen's mother, who's the matriarch of the family, tells the serving staff to allow Beethoven to treat their home as his own and to have unlimited access to the house, the music room, the piano, and the kitchen. Now, this is incredibly important for young Beethoven, whose life in his own home is anything but idyllic. And this was really a refuge for Beethoven from the chaos in which he was living. The von Brünnings also saw it as their duty to expand Beethoven's social network and introduced him to their friend, Count Wolstein, who was a Viennese aristocrat and a music lover. Wolstein was incredibly impressed by Beethoven's talent and commissioned several works from the composer. The relationship between the Count and Beethoven epitomizes the compromise musicians had to make between their ideals and their wallets. In practical terms, composers needed the support of the aristocratic patrons to fund their creations, the creations of their music, even if they, the composers, espoused democratic values. We hear this in Beethoven's music. It's the voice of a new epoch, thunderous and determined to be heard. It's not the music that flatters like the music of other periods. It's rugged and explosive, full of movement, changes of mood, contradictions, and conflict. And it's not surprising that he wrote music like this. He was the child of a revolution. But it's, what perhaps is strange is how many nobles, those potentially not supportive of the revolution, still wanted to be part of Beethoven's musical revolution and his life. Falstein was Beethoven's first great patron in Bonn. He helped enable Beethoven to move to Vienna, the cultural capital, in 1792 to study with the great Haydn. When Beethoven left, he had his friends sign his autograph book. Falstein said, "May you receive the spirit of Mozart through the hands of Haydn." Beethoven's Falstein Sonata, Opus 53, was dedicated to this patron. Beethoven arrived in Vienna, he had a letter of introduction from Count Falstein to Prince Karl Lichnowsky, one of Vienna's foremost patrons of the arts. This introduction not only secured him a small apartment in the attic of the Lichnowsky's sumptuous apartments, but a patron of immeasurable worth. He was soon performing in the Friday concerts in the Lichnowsky Salon and meeting the artistically influential men and women of Vienna. And at these concerts, many of his early premieres were received. Beethoven didn't treat the prince well and found his attention both irritating and oppressive, and would snub the prince in public. But Lichnowsky was forgiving of this young man's treatment of him, and it was on his recommendation that several other noblemen offered commissions and various forms of support to Beethoven. Beethoven dedicated several works to Lichnowsky, including his Second Symphony and his Pathetique Sonata. The Pathetique was composed in 1798 and was influenced by Schiller's theory of tragedy and tragic art, about human suffering, but also about the struggle to resist suffering and to fight against it. This fight against suffering can be seen both in his relationship with the aristocrat, but also more on a personal level, as this is the period when he begins to hear buzzing in his ears. Years after Prince Lichnowsky began paying Beethoven that 600 florins a year, the income ceases abruptly in 1806. Lichnowsky had taken Beethoven away to his country estate in Graz in August 1806 for some R&R, basically, as his hearing got worse. And one evening, some French officers were invited to dinner, and Lichnowsky asked Beethoven if he would play for them after the meal. Beethoven refused to do this. After Napoleon had made himself emperor in 1804, Beethoven changed from a total Francophile to a staunch Austrian patriot. And not only would he not play when he was told to play if he didn't feel like it, he was nobody's pet monkey, he would definitely not play for a bunch of Frenchmen. And nobody, especially an aristocrat, was going to tell Beethoven what to do. He stormed out of the estate and severed ties with the patron. And it was at this time that Beethoven stated that quote that I read before about there being plenty of princes, but only one Beethoven. Despite Lichnowsky's persistent efforts at reconciliation, Beethoven never allowed the relationship to resume its earlier intimacy, and the allowance was stopped. In Lichnowsky's declining years, he would climb the four flights of stairs to Beethoven's apartment and sit outside and listen to him play. Beethoven never allowed him in. But Lichnowsky told the servant that he was content just to sit and listen to the remarkable young man for whom he had done so much. But the more that Beethoven associated with aristocrats, the more he despised them and the way they often treated their musicians. Beethoven refused to be put in his place. He demanded to be seated at the head table with royalty. When other musicians would arrive at court wearing wigs and silk stockings, he would come in commoner's clothes. The composer Luigi Cherubini said he resembled an unlicked bear cub. As we saw, he refused to play when he wasn't in the mood. And when he did play and people spoke over him, he would explode and call them names. When he improvised and moved listeners to tears, he would chastise them for crying instead of clapping. His friend Carl Czerny said he knew how to produce such an effect upon every hearer that frequently not an eye remained dry, while many would break into loud sobs. Most musicians would have been fired for this sort of behavior, but Beethoven's talent was too magnetic. And it's remarkable how many members of high society recognized Beethoven's genius and furthered his career. They didn't seem disturbed at all by his urge of independence or his lack of manners. In this early period, Beethoven was actually much more well known in Vienna as a pianist rather than as a composer. And it was at this time that noblemen would invite the great improvisers of the city to their palaces for a competition. Beethoven always won these events, and very soon he was being touted as the next Mozart. He was also beginning to be seen as a gifted composer. And in 1795, the 24-year-old premiered his second piano concerto, performing as the soloist. This is Lichnowsky again. As his reputation continued to grow, so did his ability to support himself on the stipends he received from aristocrats. In return, Beethoven frequently dedicated new compositions to his patrons. Prince Franz Joseph Maximilian von Lobkowitz and the Russian ambassador Count Andrei Romanovsky were important patrons. Lobkowitz was an amateur musician. He played the violin and the cello, and he apparently had a beautiful bass voice. His sister-in-law said of him, "This prince was as kind-hearted as a child and the most foolish music enthusiast. He played music from dusk till dawn and spent a fortune on musicians. Innumerable musicians gathered in his home who he treated regally." In fact, if you think about it, at the beginning of the 1800s, if you're going to have music in your house from dusk till dawn, there's only one way that happens, and that's with live musicians playing it. And in fact, he lost his fortune by spending so much money on musicians and funding premieres, including in 1798, the premiere of Joseph Haydn's The Creation. Lobkowitz had a private orchestra in his palace in Vienna, and here are some photos of his home. So that huge building is his palace, and this is the internal of one of the rooms. So quite phenomenal. So he had a private orchestra in his palace in Vienna, and in its hall it performed in 1804 Beethoven's Third Symphony before the first public performance. Now, this piece was originally dedicated to Napoleon, but after he was sworn in as emperor in 1804, Beethoven rededicated this piece to the prince, probably a good idea as the prince was paying for it. But this is the first piece where Beethoven really breaks free of the shackles of the classical period. It's twice as long as any other symphony up until this point. It's full of virile energy. It's not a piece of entertainment. It was designed to shock and to move, to inspire action. It doesn't speak, it declaims. And the first two chords are like a man slamming his fist on the table, demanding to be heard. We're going to listen to a little bit from a fantastic movie, BBC movie, called Beethoven's Eroica, which reenacts this whole performance at Lobkowitz's home.
The piece is on. Stop.
Bloody hell.
Says it's about Napoleon. How may a piece of music be said to be about something?
I've never seen anything like it. It may not be music at all.
You lot were supposed to be good.
It's off the beat, sir.
And there's so many markings we can hardly read them.
Gentlemen, it is our first attempt. Patience, please. Even to my ears, it does sound rather fiendish. Rather difficult to play, don't you think?
Violent. Needlessly violent.
I've marked it exactly as I want it played. The marking here, you see, sforzando.
Sforzando.
A sharp attack to each note, Your Highness. I'm really hammering it.
How modern.
Look, my friend, you're trained to make a beautiful sound. But I don't want a beautiful sound. Elsewhere, yes, but not here.
And here we have the beginning of this wonderful piece.
That's it, yes. Punch every accent. When it was first performed, the public resented being questioned over the music, having to think and to listen, not just have music wash over them. This was about ideas, not just about pleasant tunes. Lobkowitz understood the enormity of this work and how controversial it was, although he may have been surprised if he knew the extent of its revolutionary ideas. Beethoven dedicated several works to the prince, his 3rd, 5th and 6th symphonies, his string quartets opus 18 and 74, his triple concerto and his song cycle Under Fern Geliebt. The 3 Ramanowski string quartets opus 59 were written in 1806, commissioned by the Russian ambassador in Vienna, Count Andrei Ramanowski. Beethoven used a characteristically Russian tune or theme in the first 2 quartets to honor the count. When the first violin saw his part for these quartets, he told Beethoven that not only were they impossible to play, but to understand. Beethoven's response was, "They are not for you, but for future generations."
Thank you.
of his life, Beethoven did have one other royal patron, Archduke Rudolf of Austria-Hungary, the youngest son of Emperor Franz, who was himself a proficient pianist and composer and Beethoven's sole compositional student. Beethoven dedicated the greatest number of works to the Archduke, including his fourth and fifth piano concertos, his piano sonatas, Hammerklavier and Les Adieux, the Great Fugue and the Missa Solemnis. The Missa Solemnis was meant to have been performed in 1820 on the occasion of Rudolf's coronation as Archbishop of Omsk, but the Mass, which Beethoven once described as his greatest work, wasn't finished until 3 years later. For Beethoven, his art always came first. The Great Fugue, which everyone questioned as to whether it was actually music or not. And here is a little bit of the Missa Solemnis. Musicologist Lewis Lockwood wrote, As much as Beethoven scorned other aristocrats, he was deferential to the Archduke, and he took pride in this high social connection. Beethoven wrote that Rudolf treated him as a friend and not a servant. And Beethoven would often grumble about having to teach Rudolf three times a week and would often cancel one of these lessons, to which the Archduke would grumble and complain, to which Beethoven would remind the Archduke in no uncertain terms that he was the teacher and the Archduke was just the student. Beethoven also, we see in his writings, would criticize the Archduke when he made mistakes in his compositions. And this was something that was just not done at the time. A person in Beethoven's social position would never have criticized an aristocrat. But for Beethoven, court etiquette was ignored. But this friendship between Beethoven and Rudolf lasted for almost three decades. Even though Beethoven continued to show disdain for the aristocrats, especially as his hearing got worse, he wasn't afraid to fudge his own heritage. He would sometimes pretend that the van in his name, Ludwig van Beethoven, pointed to noble heritage like the German von, which was definitely not the case. The name simply indicated Flemish forefathers. So the fact that he was Ludwig van Beethoven simply meant he was Flemish. But if people were confused, he never fixed the situation, which may have indicated his embarrassment at his own lowly upbringing. There's also an interesting story between Beethoven and the writer Goethe. Goethe was 21 years older than Beethoven, and his social attitudes were much more shaped by the formal age of the classical period than Beethoven, who truly believed that the only true aristocrats were artists. There's an incident when the two of them were walking arm in arm down the street, Beethoven and Goethe, and they see royalty coming in the other direction. Beethoven turns to Goethe and says, "Keep walking," to which Goethe drops his arm from Beethoven, falls to the side, and doffs his hat and bows to the aristocrats. Beethoven, on the other hand, powers through this entourage. So they have to move to the side and they doff their hats and bow to him. When Goethe joins Beethoven at the other side of this altercation, Beethoven says to Goethe, "I've waited for you because I respect you and admire your work, but you have shown too much esteem for those people." This not only strikingly indicates how times had changed from Goethe's time to Beethoven's, but how respected Beethoven was and tolerated by the aristocrats, who almost treated him as an equal and could have this sort of jovial exchange with a composer like Beethoven. But I suppose the question that kept on coming up for me when I was researching Beethoven was, why were these aristocrats so interested in him? Yes, he was a genius, but his music was totally different from that being written anywhere else. It was revolutionary music, music that demanded thinking and understanding, music that was so unlike the music of Mozart, Haydn, or anyone else writing at the time. This was music that questions, that demands attention. It's not calm, it shocks and disturbs. It's the music that makes you think and feel. It's not the music as the background for a sumptuous dinner. Beethoven's music was the dinner. And it's true that these men were men who were enlightened thinkers, members of the Enlightenment, but still the revolutionary aspect of Beethoven's music must have felt rebellious to them. But also maybe it made them feel alive and progressive in a world where progress is being felt firsthand in France with social revolution and in England with the industrial one, but maybe not so in Germany. And it's also not surprising that after the Congress of Vienna in 1814, where the heads of Europe tried to bring Europe back to its pre-revolutionary glory and, in fact, with the help of Prince Metternich, turn much of Europe into a police state, that Beethoven and his music turned completely out of fashion. Beethoven's rework Fidelio was performed 20 times during the Congress, but after that, he and his music was barely heard. Vienna was inundated with spies, and revolutionary music was just too scary. Italian composers like Rossini became the music of choice, and Beethoven was all but forgotten. Excuse me. We're now going to hear a little bit of Rossini, followed by a little bit of Beethoven. Compared to Beethoven. Between 1815 and 1820, he wrote only six great works, which were not highly received at the time. He and his music was profoundly unfashionable and against the new spirit of the time. Germans didn't want music that would incite ideas. They wanted music for simple enjoyment. The Missa Solemnis, the Grosse Fugue, the late string quartets were all music ahead of their time. Music that delves into the human soul, so much so that people seriously thought he'd gone mad. Maybe his deafness had given him a license to write from the depth of his being. Romantic thinkers like E.T.A. Hoffmann and Goethe praised Beethoven's instrumental music as a place for solace and truth. The censor cannot hold anything against a musician, Franz Grillparzer told Beethoven, if they only knew what you think about in your music. By now, although Beethoven did still have friends in high places, he'd lost many of his aristocratic friends. Some were bankrupt from the war, others had lost power, and others had simply died. Archduke Rudolf was one of the few exceptions, outliving Beethoven by 4 years. And the royal house? They totally ignored him. Beethoven's final statement to his revolution in music was his Ninth Symphony. It was originally commissioned by the Philharmonia Society in London in 1817, although the majority of it was written between 1822 and 1824. The choral section of the fourth movement comes from Schiller's Ode to Joy. Initially, he wanted Ode to Freedom, Freiheit, but because of the political situation, he changed it to Joy, Freud. Initially, it was meant to be performed in Berlin, as Beethoven didn't want to honour the Viennese, who had ignored him for so many years. But when his friends and financiers heard this, they urged him to premiere it in Vienna and actually got a petition started. When Beethoven heard this, he agreed. On the 7th of May, 1824, Vienna's theatre was packed. Beethoven had spent months preparing the nearly 200 musicians, including four soloists. He also had to deal with censors who didn't want some religious music to be played in the theatre, as some of the Missa Solemnis was also on the programme. This was Beethoven's first time on stage in 12 years. And although officially conducted by Beethoven, the performance was actually directed by the theatre's Kapellmeister. He had instructed both the singers and the musicians to ignore the entirely deaf Beethoven. One violinist recalls and says, Beethoven himself conducted. That is, he stood in front of the conductor's stand and threw himself back and forward like a madman. At one moment, he stretched to his full height. At the next, he crouched down on the floor. He flailed about with his hands and feet as though he wanted to play all the instruments and sing all the chorus parts. The four movements last a little over an hour compared to the 20 minutes of his first symphony. The first three movements are purely instrumental, while the last contains Schiller's ode. As each movement ended, the hall exploded with applause. At its conclusion, as the audience hollered for more, Beethoven couldn't hear as his back was turned to the audience. The alto, Caroline Unger, walked over to Beethoven and turned him around to accept the audience's cheers and applause. The applause was so loud and lasted so long that the police had to yell for silence. When the performance finished, a teary-eyed Beethoven almost fainted. Was a hit, but not with the monarchy who never showed up. Undeterred, Beethoven kept with tradition and dedicated the symphony to King Frederick Wilhelm III of Prussia. He sent the king a copy of the score, and in return, the king sent Beethoven a beautiful diamond ring. It appeared to be a gift of gratitude, but when Beethoven took the ring to a jeweler to sell it, the jeweler had bad news. The diamond was a fake. Beethoven had clearly pushed some buttons. When he died in 1827, a state funeral was organized, something that Beethoven would have raged about. With some 20,000 people filling the streets, schools were closed, soldiers were called to ensure order. Unlike Mozart's death, which barely caused a stir, Beethoven was finally lauded as the great composer he was, with pallbearers and torchbearers, including Hummel, Grillparzer, Czerny, and Schubert. At a memorial mass in a Vienna church a week later, Mozart's Requiem was sung. Beethoven's relationship with the aristocrats was complex. He needed their support both financially and socially, but in return often treated them with disdain and disrespect. They, in return, seemed to thrive on this mistreatment, continuing to help Beethoven's career. This relationship marked the beginning of a new set of values, which helped bring about the new age of the Romantic period. Thank you. I hope you enjoy that. I'm going to stop the share now so I can see you all. And if anybody would like to ask any questions, please just unmute yourself and do. That would be lovely. Thank you so much.
Andy, that was fantastic. So enjoyed it.
Oh, thank you, Nessie. Thank you. Any questions? Or just a nice statement.
I was waiting for the Moonlight Sonata.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's one of my pieces I learned.
Oh, it is. It is spectacular. It's too much. You can't put it all on.
It was fabulous. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Does anyone have any other questions? Any questions that they would like?
Yeah. Andy?
Yes.
You can't see me, I think. But anyway, it doesn't matter.
That's okay.
Look, thank you also. That was just superb.
Thank you.
I'm really stunned, you know, at his relationship and his self-confidence to be rude to his...
Yes, I can't see that.
And yes.
Hello?
Sorry, say that again, Jack. Sorry, I missed you. Say that again.
I'm amazed at his self-confidence and rudeness to his backers. At a time when, like in the last episode, when he was going deaf and he became depressed and didn't want to show his face, and yet he was able to be so rude to his backers. It's just amazing.
It really is amazing, especially when you put it at the time and place. I mean, I think it's so hard for us to understand exactly how important etiquette was and social etiquette in this time. I mean, for him to even question the Archduke and say that his pieces weren't good was, I mean, absolute heresy. For him to then treat so many of these aristocrats with total disdain it's honestly something that I don't think that we could possibly get our head around. It's a situation that we can't understand in the 21st century. It's absolute total audacity. And I suppose for some reason, maybe because of genius, he got away with it.
which means they recognized him.
They recognized
his genius.
They did. But total genius. But
yes, I mean, what?
But we also have to look at his music. I mean, we listen to his music and we see it in retrospect as he felt most of his music was going to be seen. He felt that most people weren't going to understand his later works, but it was going to be in future generations that people understood it, which is exactly what happened. But so many, for people to still see at the time that his music was amazing is incredible, because it was so different from what was being written. I mean, listen to some Carl Weber and some Beethoven at the same time, both writing at the same time, and you can't believe that you have these two composers writing music in the same place. It's just insane. So any other questions or statements or anything? No, well, if that's it, thank you very much, everybody. In 2 weeks' time, we'll have our last, where I'm looking at Beethoven's legacy. It's very interesting how not only was he perceived, as we were saying at the time, but how important he has been for future generations from literally the time of his death until today. So have a good couple of weeks, and I will see you all hopefully in a couple of weeks. So have a great time. Thank you for all the chats. I will have a look at them now. Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much,
everybody. Thank you, and I'll see you in a couple of weeks' time.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. And again, if you have any other questions, just email me. Absolutely fine. See you all then.